this video, we're going to cover the citric acid cycle or the Krebs cycle. We're going to break down the reactions involved and the energy yield and net result of the cycle. Now, before we go through the reactions, let's first review how we ended up here. So let's begin with glycolysis. So in glycolysis, we took a molecule of glucose and we broke that down in a series of enzymatic reactions to two molecules of pyruvate. The pyruvate that we've produced in the cytosol is then transported into the mitochondrial matrix by the mitochondrial pyruvate carrier, where it's converted to acetyl-CoA. And this is catalyzed by the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. The acetyl-CoA can then enter the citric acid cycle to be oxidized to release energy and form ATP molecules. So where does the cycle occur? It occurs in the mitochondrial matrix, and our goal here is to release energy by oxidizing acetyl-CoA to carbon dioxide and water. The cycle also captures energy by electron transfer to NADH and FADH2. And NADH and FADH2 are important electron carriers. So the cycle is also a major source of NADH and FADH2. And these electron carriers are then going to donate their electrons to the respiratory chain. So later on, when we look at the net result, you're going to see how the cycle generates a small amount of ATP by harnessing electrons and transferring it to NADH and FADH2, which will produce a lot of ATP molecules during oxidative phosphorylation. So now let's subtract complexity by breaking down the eight reactions step by step. Okay, so in step one, we're going to start off with acetyl-CoA, which is a 2-carbon, and this is going to join, or more accurately, condense with oxaloacetate, which is a 4-carbon, and we're going to produce citrate. This is catalyzed by citrate synthase. Now, the CoA in acetyl-CoA is very important because it accepts the acyl group, and this acyl group is linked to the thiol group via a thioester bond. And the reason why this is important is because thioester bonds have a high standard free energy of hydrolysis. And in this first reaction here, it undergoes hydrolysis. And because of this high energy, it makes the reaction highly exergonic, and it's going to drive the cycle forward. This is crucial because the concentration of oxaloacetate is low. So the negative standard free energy is going to help drive the cycle forward. So from citrate, let's move on to step number two. So citrate is transformed into isocitrate via the formation of cis aconitate. And this is catalyzed by aconitase. And this reaction here is reversible. So let's break this down. So first of all, citrate is turned into cis aconitate via a dehydration reaction. And then it's turned into isocitrate by a hydration reaction. So what we've done here is we've removed the water and then we've added the water. And what's happening there is the hydroxyl group is moved from carbon 2 to carbon 3. Okay, so now what happens to isocitrate? In step 3, isocitrate is going to be oxidized to form alpha-ketoglutarate and carbon dioxide. Isocitrate loses one carbon in this oxidative decarboxylation. So decarboxylation is when we're releasing or removing carbon dioxide. This reaction here is catalyzed by isocitrate dehydrogenase, and we produce NADH. What happens is there is a hydride transfer to NAD+ or NADP+, and this depends on the isozyme. So what isozymes are, there are different proteins that catalyze the same reaction. So here, it's specific for either NADP+, which is systolic, or NAD+, which is mitochondrial. So then in the next step, it's going to be another oxidative decarboxylation. Alpha-ketoglutarate is oxidized to form succinyl-CoA and carbon dioxide. And this is catalyzed by the alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase complex. In this step, NAD+ is reduced to NADH. So NAD+ accepts these electrons and it's going to carry it to the respiratory chain. And another thing in this step is we're going to be conserving energy in the thioester bond of succinyl-CoA. And recall I mentioned that Thioester bonds have large negative standard free energy of hydrolysis, and this is going to be important in the next step, where we're transforming succinyl-CoA to succinate. So that's the next step. We're going to be converting succinyl-CoA to succinate. So this reaction is reversible, and it's catalyzed by succinyl-CoA synthetase. So the thioester bond that's high in energy is going to be used to produce GTP or ATP. So GDP, an inorganic phosphate, combines and forms GTP. Now I want to quickly mention that GTP and ATP are energetically equivalent. And this step here, another thing, this is what's called a substrate level phosphorylation. Okay, so then moving on to the next reaction, step number 6, succinate is oxidized to form fumarate. And this is a dehydrogenation reaction. And we're also going to be forming FADH2. And this is done by the succinate dehydrogenase enzyme. And succinate dehydrogenase is actually bound to the inner mitochondrial membrane, and it's also attached to FAD. It's covalently attached. So in the oxidative phosphorylation lecture, you're going to see this connection. So in this reaction, we transferred the electrons to FADH2. And recall that FADH2 is an important electron carrier. So then FADH2 is going to donate its electrons to the respiratory chain. But because succinate dehydrogenase is bound to the inner mitochondrial membrane, the electrons can enter the electron transport chain here. So our product in this step was fumarate. The next reaction is a hydration step. It's a reversible hydration of fumarate to malate, and this is catalyzed by fumarase. Now malate is oxidized to oxaloacetate by malate dehydrogenase, and NAD+ is reduced to NADH. And this NADH is going to carry these electrons to the respiratory chain. And oxaloacetate can then condense with acetyl-CoA again to form citrate by citrate synthetase. And because oxaloacetate is very low, the exergonic first reaction is going to help drive the cycle forward. So now we have just completed one turn of the cycle. But remember that we produced two pyruvate molecules in glycolysis. So then two pyruvate molecules are going to be converted to two acetyl-CoA molecules. So then we would have two acetyl-CoA entering the cycle. So then the cycle is going to be turning twice. So those are the reactions of the cycle, but there are a lot of intermediates involved. So surely there's an easier way to remember the intermediates of the cycle. Now, the way I personally remember the intermediates is by saying the CIA sings country songs for me on stage. So the C stands for citrate. The I for isocitrate, the A for alpha-ketoglutarate, sings country is succinyl-CoA, so the country stands for CoA, songs for succinate, for fumarate, me for malate, and on stage for oxaloacetate. So you can use this saying to remember the intermediates and never forget it again. So now let's take all the reactions and determine the energy yield and net result of the cycle. Let's add all this up. So for each NADH molecule, you can make 2.5 ATP equivalent. And for each FADH2 molecule, you can make 1.5 ATP. So here we've produced 6 NADH, giving us 15, 2 FADH2, giving us 3, and 2 ATP was produced from substrate level phosphorylation. And just remember that GTP and ATP are energetically equivalent. So our total ATP equivalent here is 20. Now for one turn of the cycle, 3 NADH is generated, 1 FADH2, and 1 GTP. But the cycle goes through two cycles, which is how we generated 6 NADH, 2 FADH2, and 2 ATP. Okay, so now let's go over how much ATP is being generated taking all the pathways starting from glycolysis. So in glycolysis, we produce net 2 ATP, and we also produce 2 NADH. So for this NADH, the ATP equivalent is 5, and the total for glycolysis here is 7. So then the pyruvate molecules that we've produced in glycolysis can be oxidized to acetyl-CoA, and we generate 2 NADH, giving us a total of 5 ATP here. And then the acetyl-CoA can enter the cycle, and we already covered this, and our total ATP equivalent is 20. So now let's calculate the total number of ATP molecules produced per one glucose molecule that is oxidized under aerobic conditions. So the total that we can produce is 32. So total yield per glucose molecule is 32. So that is the citric acid cycle. In this lecture, we learned how pyruvate is transported into the mitochondrial matrix where it's converted to acetyl-CoA. We broke down the 8 reactions that's involved in the cycle, and we also calculated the total ATP yield per one glucose molecule that is oxidized under aerobic conditions. Thank you for watching this video. Make sure you subscribe to EKG Science so you don't miss a single lecture. And remember, subtract complexity and slow down. To study the next lecture, simply click the next video, or you can view the entire metabolism playlist. Hey, stop procrastinating!